Hello, and welcome to Gilmore's Glorious Gossip, a show dedicated to Critical Role over on the Geek & Sundry Twitch channel. Welcome to all of you beautiful people joining us live. And don't worry, if you can't today, we will be posting this on Monday, as we always do. Many eternal thanks to our newly updated and ever-festive logo.
I just saw that.
Yes, many thanks for that to Akuma Mika at EmmaFrost91. This week features 7 more amazing artists. The current art. There we go. The current art that you're seeing is by Yule Bird at Becca underscore Riverbird, BECCA underscore RIVERBIRD. And later you'll be seeing pieces from Jakuven at Jackorg, Dipod Fight Game at Blooper Villain, BLUPER Villain, Wolfmenge at Anime Bez. A piece by Elaine Tipping at TriaElf9. A piece by the ever-awesome Sir Joe Malicious, Joma Queto at Forging Meanings. And finally, a piece by our eternal Akuma Mika at EmmaFrost91.
Some of these pieces are hot, by the way. Guys, prepare yourselves.
Yes. Unfortunately, one of them I did have to censor just a little bit, simply because YouTube has its terms and services. So don't be surprised. Don't worry. We will make sure that in the video when it goes live, we'll have all of the Twitter names on there. As we do each and every week, so you can look them up online and see any uncensored versions. But blame YouTube. If you'd like your art featured here, please let any of our show's hosts know via Twitter, either at Gilmore underscore Gossip or our direct Twitters, and we'll do our best to get it on the show. And don't forget to like and subscribe so you can catch us each and every week. I'm Akiva, found on Twitter at Akiva David, AKIVADAPHYDD. And joining me today is my excellent friend. Please introduce yourself and tell us, what is the most important part of world building to you?
Good question. Hi, guys. I'm Kat, also known as CatsLL Games on Twitter, CATSSTI3L Games. I think. The most important part of world building, I suppose, purpose. I've often been in and watched games where things are done and put into a world with no true purpose or history or meaning. So I suppose whenever you do anything within your world, ask yourself, why is it here? What purpose does it serve? You know, what was its history? What was its backstory? Whether it be a town, a village, a city. If you give things meaning and purpose, then it'll come alive. That's probably the most important thing for me.
That's a good point. However, I will counterpoint that. If you want this to be a living, breathing world, there's going to be stuff without history and without meaning. I mean, that's the case in real life. The difference is, how much emphasis do you put on it?
So, oh, sure. I mean, your players may never know
exactly
what that purpose of meaning is. But if you as a DM know, or have an idea, it can help you a lot with interactions with your players. It can give you a little bit of a motivational point to pull from, I suppose, when you're doing things.
Yeah. So for me, the most important part of world building is the not necessarily an item having a history, but having a why. Why is it there? It could be as simple as, hey, we're traveling on a well-traveled road. Somebody tossed out a bottle because they didn't have anywhere to store trash. But by the same token, you know, how much emphasis you as the DM, how much emphasis the players put on that random bottle that's nothing but garbage, that's going to determine how the story goes. So be careful what you put in to your world.
Yeah. Sounds good.
So, with that, although I edited it, or added it to the links in last week's episode, I just wanted to make sure that it was put out verbally. Last week, the Persalia Supercut, it was edited together by SoaringSparrows.tumblr.com. I don't know if Soaring Sparrows has a Twitter or not, but there's the Tumblr, SoaringSparrows.tumblr.com. And some of the art assets for the lettering and such were created by Amanda Lien at Alien First over on Twitter. And I've included the link to that supercut again, just because it is a beautiful supercut. And if you haven't seen it, you really should.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
This week, there was a new GM tips released, and Matthew Mercer went evil. How to curb murder hobos or run an evil campaign. So, it's
not an easy thing to do.
No, it's not. When everybody's thinking only of themselves, they tend to get more into player versus player than they do player versus world.
Yes.
So. And finally, two more Spotify lists have been released, and I couldn't think of any more appropriate playlist to be released than Vexes and Percys. So, those are out. Links are in the description below. Check those out whenever you get a chance. They are glorious. But that will bring us to comments from last Gilmore's Glorious Gossip. And this one comes from The Dragon Rune over here on YouTube. Who writes, I thought Scanlan used Dominate Person during the beginning of the Briarwood arc with Stonefell. I haven't gone back and looked yet. I have been in busy moving house, so I have not been able to check yet. But it is possible, which may explain why Sam had an issue with what Matt did with the Dominate Person spell on Vex. However, it is also possible that Sam was thinking Charm Person, which I know he did use in the Underdark on one of the Duragar, and Matt told him that he couldn't have the Duragar that was charmed attack itself or jump into lava or anything that would be harmful. So so there's that. That will bring us into our Talks Machina moments. And this week we had some rather interesting choices of guests. It started with the Pit Crew.
The Pit Crew!
Go ahead.
Yeah, it's pretty good. I was so happy that, we got to actually sit down with them. That was a great idea.
The behind-the-scenes love was just awesome.
Yeah.
Because, yeah. I mean, these are the guys that, as much as Matt puts on a glorious story, and the cast just are amazing people. Without the Pit crew, none of this would really be possible.
Yes.
So I'm glad we got to see them. It was Amir Raqib, Dustin, and I could not, for the life of me, grab his last name. So I apologize, Dustin, if you're watching. And also Ryan Green. So we got to talk with them for a little bit. And then later on in the episode, Matt, Marisha, and Liam came on. Now, I don't want to spoil things. Kat, was there anything about the Pit Crew interview that you wanted to bring up?
No, just basically his catchphrase at the end, or that very last question. I think he answered it perfectly. We know.
Yes.
And that became our hashtag, like, in seconds. Like, everyone's like, hashtag, we know. So yes. I'm looking forward to seeing that be a continued thing now that critics can use when there is that bashing on the Pit Crew, which does happen in chat every now and then. I'm hoping that the critters just keep that hashtag live and use it to, like, just support the Pit Crew, I think,
yes,
when they need that support. So.
Pit Crew really need to have our support. A lot of the technical issues, you know, it's not their fault. They're technical issues, which means they're issues with the hardware and software. Those happen, guys. They've happened to us. So, if you're listening to this and you're one of those individuals that likes hating on the Pit Crew, please don't.
Yeah.
Like, it's one thing to mention, hey, volume is a little too loud, or volume is a little too soft, because that's giving feedback. It's another thing to be like, what do you guys think you're doing with the volume? Are you deaf? Can you not hear it? Blah, 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 whatever. Don't throw hate. It's never nice. I did want to... I am glossing over the majority of their interview. It's a lot of good information from a technical and producer standpoint, and we here on Gilmore's Glorious Gossip are focused more on the story. So, I am glossing over it, and it is a big injustice to the Pit Crew for that. I am sorry, but we do need to maintain our focus. So, getting into the interview with Matt, Marisha, and Liam, I do want to say that there were two shout-outs that were just awesome, in my personal opinion. Critical Role Transcripts, the group of individuals who are trying to get every episode of Critical Role subtitled for the hearing impaired. I can't speak today. I have a cold. I apologize. But they got a shout out. Look them up. Do a quick Google search. You'll find them very easily. I believe they still have a Kickstarter going in order to help try and get the transcripting done quicker. Trying to get more people in on the project so that we can grow the critter community. And being inclusive is just amazing. And there was the other shout out was to the Thordak at the Cinder King Twitter account. I've been following that account pretty much since it got started. It is hilarious. If you guys haven't seen
it's pretty good.
Yes. Check it out. There have been a couple of times where we here at Gilmore's Glorious Gossip have bantered with Thordak. I love the engageability and just the whole character of that particular parody account. So. There was also an announcement from Tox Machina Kat, do you want to do the honors?
From Tox Machina? Where are we?
Announcements?
The announcement?
The announcement.
That it is going to be on Twitch indefinitely?
Yes!
Woo! Yay!
So that brings up the question. So Kat and I have talked about it. We're going to continue. Obviously, we're going to continue watching it because, well, we're critters and Tox Machina is about our favorite show. But, or our favorite internet show, that is. So, the question is, do you want us to continue doing a full report on Tox Machina? Or do you want us to do as Kat suggested and I agree with, just picking out one or two points each, maybe 3 points each, that we want to talk about, 3 questions that were asked that we feel are pretty big questions. So let us know in the comments below if you're watching this on the video. Let us know in the chat if you want us to just do the cherry picking or if you want us to do the full format. So getting into the rest of the interview, there was a congratulations thrown out to Laura and Ashley for their PSX showing. Uncharted started off PSX, and The Last of Us brought it to a close. So we had Critical Role bookending the PlayStation experience. So.
Yes.
The cast was asked if they had any plans for the 100th episode special. And, you know, honestly, they haven't planned that far in advance. Matt hasn't planned that far in advance. I know I certainly haven't even thought about that part that far in advance. But there are some critters who
have. It'd be a bit difficult to really plan that. You're not quite sure where they're going to be in a couple of months' time.
Exactly.
So I suppose it's something that they're just going to have to plan. Probably they'll probably plan it like a week out. Because I have a bit more of an idea as to where their characters are at and what's happening in the world. And what they're available to do, I guess, with their bookings and everything. So, but I'm sure they're going to do something awesome.
Yes. It's Critical Role. You know whatever they do is going to be awesome. If only because it's Vox Machina.
So true.
And also something that was brought up, Critical Role appeared in Game Informer, which blew my mind. I haven't been keeping up with Game Informer for a while, but one thing I do know is that Game Informer is primarily a video game magazine. So, Critical Role, a tabletop RPG getting into a video game magazine, is a big deal.
Mm.
So. Yeah. The party was asked about the recount of allies. They didn't really get too in-depth, but they did touch on the fact that they have the army there. Marisha brought up the possibility of the Ashari joining. And then, of course, the usual crew, guests, reoccurring NPCs, and so on. One of my favorite questions of the evening was a question regarding our patron, Sean Gilmore himself. What was Matt's inspiration for Gilmore, and how did Vax's relationship with Sean start? Liam started off answering with how the relationship started on from his point of view. Gilmore wasn't meant to be a reoccurring character. He just sort of turned into that. And then... So when Liam, first interacted with Gilmore, it was just one of those larger-than-life moments.
Yeah. It really stuck, and I liked that we got to see those two points of view of that meeting. It's kind of like, anybody, any kind of couple or relationship when you meet for the first time and getting to see both sides of the story there. And we've heard about what's inspired Gilmore. Matt's actually said that a number of times across panels and everything like that. But we never really heard about the story of when they really met. And that was interesting. I like that.
Absolutely. And in case anyone has missed the panels where Matt talked about the inspiration, Gilmore is based on an old theater friend of Matt's. Somebody who just had one of those larger-than-life, glamorous personality where all attention is centered on them. They don't even realize it, and it's not meant in a malicious sort of way. And Matt wanted to convey that, and so there was Gilmore.
Yes. As John said, I really want to know if those diplomacy roles had been reversed, what would have happened? We lucked out, I think. And yeah. I would agree, I think.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, the basic story from Matt's perspective, Vex had failed a barter check while dealing with Gilmore. But Vax came in and, sweet talked him and succeeded. And Gilmore took notice and was sort of impressed.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yes.
There was a question about Liam DMing a one-shot where Matt was a player. And Matt said he would love to. And it was brought up as a possibility for a break after Thordak.
Yeah, Liam seemed on board with it.
Oh, yeah.
Happy to take that pressure off Matt.
Well, as a fellow DM...
little bit.
Yeah, as a fellow DM, Liam realizes that there's, for those of us that do DM, there's not often a lot of ability to be players.
No.
A lot of times we get called, hey, you want to play Dungeons & Dragons? Will you DM for us?
Yes.
So, I think Liam understands that and, is making an offer to give Matt a break. Not necessarily from planning out, just giving him some more time to plan so that for 1 week, when he sits down at the table, he's not thinking about the overall story. He's thinking, what am I doing? So.
Yes.
Marisha was asked, does it seem that there is less interaction between Grog and Keyleth because of the way they're seated? Or has there been some sort of falling out or something like that that we haven't seen? And Marisha, immediately threw the blame on the seating.
Uh-huh. I wasn't sure if she was just joking about that, per se, but, I mean, not everyone interacts with everyone a lot in truth and honesty. I mean, you get certain people who have that closer relationship, so they have a lot of more interactions with each other, but it's a big party, and they're quite busy, and they're doing a lot every session. To have, specific scenes between every single player in that group, that would just I'd love to see it. I'm sure no one would complain, but I don't think they'd get anything done. So there has to be a purpose, I suppose, for them to chat. And I do remember the conversation that they recently had that Marisha pointed out about, him helping her with her rage issues.
Yes.
Which was beautiful. And you if you watch them, they are constantly egging each other on in battle. He is always really supportive of her. He's always like, yeah, you go, Marisha. Like, he's... So I don't know where that came from. I don't know how you could have thought that there would have been some kind of conflict there, because they, if you watch close enough, they are always cross-talking across the tables and supporting each other, so...
Oh, absolutely. I don't know. I mean, as Marisha said, Keyleth sort of envies Grog. And as further support that they are good friends... You know, she really respects Grog for showing wisdom in helping her control her anger.
Yes.
Which kind of took me by surprise. Because it's an interesting take on the barbarian rage.
Yeah.
The stereotype for barbarian rage is that when a barbarian goes into battle, they lose themselves to their rage.
Lose control. Yeah.
Whereas... For Travis, he's taking it as barbarians channel and focus their rage.
Which I love. That's
absolutely
awesome.
Absolutely.
Yeah, as BJ says, I always enjoy Grog and Keyleth's / Travis and Marisha's interactions. They're few and far between, but almost always gems. I agree.
Agreed. Now, one thing I will say, you had mentioned just briefly about wanting to see interactions amongst all of them. That's when we get the At Dawn We Plan scenes.
Yeah. And chaos ensues.
Yes.
So. Oh boy.
But at the same time, those are interesting and fun. So. Matt was asked about his DM pet peeves and about the crosstalk issue that has been brought up in a lot of the different critter chats.
Yes.
So before we get into Matt's answer, that should have been this week's question. I thought I had asked it once before, but I went through and I couldn't find the answer. What are your pet peeves as a DM, Kat?
My pet peeves would have to be... Well, I've discussed about players just rolling dice without consulting the Dungeon Master. That's a hate. The moment you start rolling dice and making up your own DCs, and then I come back to you and you're like, oh, I rolled all this dice and I did all these things, I'm like, no. I'm sorry, mate. No. So that's probably my biggest no-no. I'm okay with a little bit of table talk. I feel like it's a game, and you can't be too restrictive with that kind of stuff. It's when it goes into the metagaming that it's a problem. But I would say that, so rolling dice and people talking while you're talking, which I know... gets on Matt a little bit every now and then, because you'll see him just kind of like I'm talking, and every DM has that where they're trying to, you know, they're trying to say something, and the players are like talking amongst themselves. You're like, guys, hello, you want to listen to this? So that's mine too.
So yeah, for me, I fall in line with Matt. Matt's answer was pretty much the same as mine, challenging the DM, meaning rules lawyering.
Yes. See, I don't mind that so much, but
I hate it because, you know, being a story-based DM, my first thought is, what works for the story? If having a tidal wave be 50 feet wide and 300 feet tall instead of 50 feet tall and 300 feet wide works for the story, then it's going to be 50 feet wide and 300 feet tall.
Right. Yeah.
But, you know, you've got the rules lawyers out there. Your fun is wrong.
Yeah. That's true.
So, but for Matt, crosstalk is not normally that big of an issue, especially since you know, even in combat, there's going to be people communicating with each other.
Yes.
Like, hey, I need support over here. Or, hey, can you toss this spell over here? Hey, so-and-so needs healing. That's normal in combat. I've been through real-life combat. That's normal. That's not metagaming, guys. That's just crosstalk. It happens. Metagaming, there is a certain level of that that Matt does try to curb. But on for the most part, he does like I do. And sort of plans for a certain amount of metagaming. Because otherwise, maybe a puzzle is just a little too esoteric for the characters. And you kind of need that metagaming in order to actually solve it. Or maybe it's, you know, an opportunity for the DM to to expand on the story or change something in the story.
Yeah.
It's a way for the DM to maintain informed without blatantly asking, if that makes sense.
Sure. Yes.
So, a little bit's okay. Mm-hmm. Moving forward, the question came up, when did Keyleth first know she loved Vax? And for Marisha, she said it started. She didn't necessarily know she loved Vax, but this when she first started feeling affection towards him was when Vax first was the first to stand up for her. Because she, even today, even now, she still has a little bit of a meekness to her.
Sure.
But Vax, you know, is encouraging her to stand up and get herself out there more often. And
yeah, and I mean, that goes right back to episode one, where she put flowers on that keg of ale, I think it was, or drink that they bought, that they were going to barter to get into the mines. And she did a druidcraft on it, and everyone was giving her crap for it. And he's like, to be fair, you know, they probably don't see a lot of flowers. It's quite pretty. She did a good job. Right from episode one, he was on her side for the most part in a lot of things. So I feel like that would put Marisha in a hard place because, in truth, it was a very Vax-driven affair. And I feel like she just grew into it.
Well,
organically. So I don't think she could have told us one particular point.
I want to say yes and no. Yeah. It was a Vax-driven affair in that he was presenting the type of person that he is, but it was up to her to reciprocate. He didn't put any pressure on her.
I don't know. Well, so. Yeah, no.
I mean, it was one of those things where it took for Vax to come to the realization that he loved her took much longer than the realization that Keyleth loved him. However, Keyleth, you know, struggled with that and having to put duty first. And I think that showed through a lot of it. But speaking of Vaxleth, Liam was asked, does Vax act differently around Keyleth? Does he change plans because Keyleth's around? And Liam pretty bluntly said no. They sort of gravitated together, he feels, because they're similar in that they're trying to keep their ideals on the battlefield. But otherwise, you know, Vax does not... It's one of those quote-unquote true love stories. They're not trying to change each other. They're not changing for each other. They are helping and supporting each other to be themselves.
Yes.
Which, you know, in my opinion, is the way love stories is supposed to be.
Oh, yeah.
The way true love in real life should be.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, as Liam and the cast were talking about that, it came to light that Vaxleth, in these course of the 3 years that they've been playing, almost 4 years now, the in-game time has only been about 2 years. And Vaxleth has only been about the last 6 months to a year in-game. So that was rather interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not that much time. Yes, Robert Warden in chat is asking if Tibbsy is thawing out, and John has answered correct. They're going to build him a tomb, so he should be fine. So long as Vaxmachina actually are successful, and the world doesn't burn to ash, he will have his tomb.
Yes. And steal a jet in chat. Says, thanks, Akiva. I have the song from the end of The Princess Bride in my head. You're welcome, Steelajet. It's a great movie. Everyone needs to be reminded of it every once in a while.
That is an awesome movie.
And then to go ahead and finish out the Talks Machina section, there was some Kimalura talk that kind of upset me. Not because of anything on Matt's end. Matt was glorious in handling that, and he normalized the relationship, which I think was the perfect way to handle it.
Right.
But apparently, there have been those that, as Matt put it, have thought it was stupid. And...
Oh, yeah, well, more childish? I think he said that someone said it was childish.
It was childish.
Not necessarily stupid, but...
No, he actually used the word stupid at one point.
Oh, he did he? Oh, jeez. Yeah, that surprised me.
But...
I...
You know, and then there... We'll get to the flip side of the coin in just a moment. But it upset me because... You know, someone's dissing love. It was the normalization of a lesbian couple, and somebody was disrespecting the fact that they were in love. It doesn't matter, you know, whether it's a lesbian couple, straight couple, gay couple, trans couple, whatever. Whatever their alignment, it's love.
Yeah.
Do not disrespect love.
Yeah, I think if it was, this is, because I was thinking about it the other day and I was kind of putting it in my head of a male and a female in that same position, and I feel like it wouldn't have gotten that same reaction.
No, it wouldn't have. And it's sad.
No, it wouldn't. Yeah, and it shouldn't matter, but I mean, we've still got a long way to go, I guess is what that shows us as a community, as a race, as a world, and this is a great first step. Matt is leading the way through Dungeons and Dragons on a very important topic and a very important change that needs to occur, I guess.
Yes.
John said, for the record, Ruben put a long apology out regarding that. I'm not sure who Ruben is.
I wasn't going to call him out on it. Because again, I don't spread hate, but Ruben was the individual who had said that the relationship was essentially stupid.
Oh, okay. Sorry. No, no. Don't bother Ruben.
Don't bother him. He has apologized.
opinions.
And it's not my game. I can't say anything for the cast or anything like that. But I did read the apology. The apology was well written. Apology accepted on behalf of this critter. But that it will be up to Matt and them, and I'm sure they're great people. I'm sure that they've already forgiven him.
Wasn't just Ruben. It was a lot of comments and tweets. So
yeah. And then there's the flip side of the coin that I wanted to touch on as well. People getting a little overzealous on, hey, we need to celebrate this more. We need to make a big deal out of this. To which I say, it's a relationship of love that is, in my mind, no different from, you know, Vax and Keyleth. Or, you know, any other male-female pairing. Normalize it. This should be normal. This should be an everyday occurrence in society. Not necessarily in your hometown if you live in a small town. Because, I mean, dating options are kind of limited in a small town. But at the same time, you know, accept it, enjoy it, normalize it, let this be a showing of life, not the celebration of something that it isn't.
Yes.
And I don't want people getting the wrong idea. I fully support and I love this pairing. I really do. Yes. I am such a Kimalura shipper. So, on a personal level, I celebrate the fact that two wonderful people have gotten together.
Get ship excited.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
But I'd
really like to know, because Matt said, you know, it's a rekindling of an old flame. So now I want to know. I want to know what the story was, right? Of this couple. Like, what was it like when they were, was it when they adventured together that maybe they had a bit of a relationship? And then was it their callings that separated them on different paths? And at what point during this campaign did they rekindle? Like, was it that moment there when Kima thought that she lost Allura to Feeble Mind? Or have they rekindled before then? I don't know. Now I want all the backstory. I kind of want like a Kima Allura side story to be released or a spin-off. Because I just find them so interesting.
Absolutely. So, that being said, let's move into this week's episode. Episode 78. So, the episode picked up right after they got done in the war room. Still in the planning phases. And the party had planned to enter Amon through the secret tunnel in Grayskull Keep.
Yes, I do just want to touch on just one comment just quickly before we go.
Oh, go ahead.
Jessica in the chat said, yes, I'm on that side. Really, though, from the point of someone bisexual, it's important for us to celebrate this representation. I don't think that our overzealous reactions are unjustified. That's fair, Jessica.
Yeah, no, I'm not. Okay.
Yeah, we're not taking it away from.
I'm not trying to take it away from anybody, and I apologize if that's the impression that I gave. I need to explain myself very carefully, and I apologize that I didn't. When I say we don't want to be overzealous about it, what I mean is I don't want it to. I don't want it to be the absolutely only thing that was focused
about
on
it.
About the episode, because there were so many great things that did happen. By the same token, yes, it does need to be celebrated. I'm not saying don't celebrate it. Celebrate it, yes. But don't. I don't know how to put this.
We're looking forward to getting to a point where these kinds of things aren't such a big thing. Do you know what I mean? Like, we're looking forward to that point where people like Jessica and other critters that are bisexual, gay, lesbian, this kind of thing isn't a big thing for them anymore. It's normal. And we feel like, yes, yeah, celebrate it, but yeah, keep remember that this is just a normal relationship, and there's the more that we think about it in that way.
Okay, so you helped me frame it perfectly. Okay. Celebrate it, but don't forget that there's still a long way to go.
Yes, perfect.
Don't let this celebrate it, but don't let this become the stopping point. Is what I'm trying to say. Because for me, the connotation of, hey, we are celebrating, you know, legalized gay marriage. Great. What are you doing for your next step?
Yeah.
What do you mean? We got marriage. What are you doing for the next step? How are you normalizing the fact that these relationships exist?
Yes.
So, thank you for helping me frame that.
No worries.
So.
I'm so excited to get into the episode. Oh my god, this episode was amazing. Oh my gosh.
So, okay.
Let's do it.
So yeah, as I was saying, they plan to enter Amon through the secret tunnel in Grayskull Keep, and in order to make sure that they're going to be safe when they go to Grayskull, Keyleth does a scrying. Now, there was a little bit of talk between Marisha and Matt on if Marisha could scry on a plant rather than a creature, because the spell itself says that you can scry on a creature, not a location. You used to be able to scry on a creature or location. Now it's just on a creature.
Right.
But
I thought that was a good call.
Yes, a very good call by Matt. Because Keyleth is a druid, she is able... She knows plants so well, she is able to scry on a plant within the keep. So she scries. The keep is intact. And she's like, I want to look around to see if there's anyone around, any movement around. So she rolls... with disadvantage, a perception check, and rolls 2 nat 1s.
Yes.
Yeah, that kind of sucks.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, since the keep is intact, they, you know, decide that they're going to go ahead and risk it. That's the way they're going to go in. But before they go, they have to talk with their allies that are there in Whitestone with them. And Keyleth does not want to talk to Cash. Because she's the one who sent Kashaw on the little messenger boy. And it kind of didn't go the way she thought it would. So she tries to pawn it off. But then the rest of the party's like, well, Vex has to go talk to Zara. Scanlan's, you know, he initially volunteered to talk to Cash, but then was like, oh, no, I have to go see Jarrett.
Yes.
Percy says, hey, I've got to go talk to Cass. And Vax says, I've got to go talk to Gilmore. And of course, since Travis... and Ashley weren't there, they couldn't go talk to Cash. So Keyleth got pushed into it anyway.
She drew the short straw.
Yep. But before we get to Keyleth talking to Cash, Vex finds Zara, and Mary Elizabeth McGlynn arrives on the set.
Woo!
So Vex relays the plans and asks for her assistance in the upcoming battle, and Zara jumps on board without much prodding whatsoever.
Yes, but she was gonna get her hair done. So that's a bummer.
Yeah. But that's
She'll
okay.
have to get that done afterwards, I guess, or I don't know. She's just so funny. I love her interactions with Vex. They are alike in so many ways. But yeah, she plays her so well.
Oh yes, Zara has sort of the British sense of humor, where it's
Yes.
very dry, but at the same time to the point.
Yep.
So a lot of people miss the humor in Zara, and she's just hilarious to me. But eventually, Keyleth does find Cash, and there's so much babble. She apologizes for, how the last quote unquote mission went.
Yeah.
And it was just so hilarious.
Yeah, Wilfriedle, then also stepped onto set, and it a lot of people didn't like the Cash character in the beginning when he first came into the fray, and it really was because there was too many characters in that particular group that were grumpy. You had Tibbs, you had Vax, who was going through a depression period. And you had Wil Wheaton's character, which was this grumpy old dwarf, and everyone was just grumpy, 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 grumpy. And then you had Keyleth, who was the only happy person in that. She was like that shining light in that group. And I think that's why he was just bogged down by grump. But in the right group dynamic, in Vox Machina's group dynamic, with the way they are now, his character is just so good. I loved Cashaw in the beginning, even with that group. I personally loved him as a character, and I every time he comes on is a gem for me.
And it is so hard to play that type of character.
It is. Yeah, it is.
'Cause, I mean, granted, the game is on hiatus right now, but I have a Fire Genasi cleric that's in that mode right now. It is so hard.
Because you just want to be happy, and you just want to crack a joke, but you can't.
And here's the flip side of it. Being on the receiving end of interacting with that character is not fun.
No, well, you've got to have a good, you have to have a good group
Yes, you
to
really
have a
do.
character like that. A group that knows, how to work with that. So. He could play a character like that with a group like Vox Machina, Critical Role. Actors. They're all actors, so
Yes.
they did well.
But, in the end, Keyleth does get around to asking him for help, to which Cash responds, "What's in it for me?" And then Keyleth mentions that Zara's going to help, and Cash immediately jumps on board.
Yeah.
Marisha was
Yep.
like, "Remind me to lead with that next time."
Yep. Yes.
Now, that was a little bit of metagaming because Keyleth wasn't there for Zara joining on board. However, and this is in response to people I saw in the chats saying, "Hey, metagaming." Like, well, yeah, but at the same time, it's for the story.
Sure.
Let it go, people. So. But then we jump over to Scanlan and Jarrett. Jarrett is in a pub, getting ready for the next day. Pretty much because, Scanlan led with the question, "Hey, we'd like you to join us." And Jarrett's like, "I assumed I was." I love Jarrett.
Yes, that whole, as you're running into flames and glory, I've got to be that person at the back going, "Don't die."
Yes.
It was just, oh, I could see Jarrett doing that, like standing on a rooftop with his bow and arrow, or with his whatever it is, and just yelling after them, "Stay safe, don't die." And yeah,
Yes. Well,
he's a perfect character.
Yeah, he said straight up that he had to be there for Scanlan to remind him not to die.
Yeah.
And Scanlan, you know, offered a bonus. Jared mentions that that was a total of 4 bonuses that he's owed. And then they get into the drug deal. So, of course, they go outside so they can't be overheard. And, you know, Jarrett was only able to get one small pouch. And hands it over, and the drug is called Sude, S-U-U-D-E. But...
there you go. Yeah. Jessica says, I wonder what would happen if Cash dies. Would Veshtem be free? Would she blacken the skies as they fought Bordak?
So, the way I understand it, although Cash is the only actual cleric, there is an order dedicated to making sure that there is always a cleric to keep Vesh chained, entombed, whatever, however you want to put it. So, I think the next one in line, you know, the order would be watching for signs. And when whatever seal is keeping Vesh chained, you know, started to break down, they'd be right there. Here's your new cleric. You may now kiss the bride.
Some other poor schmuck.
Yeah. But after that, we jump over to Percy, who repairs his guns. Rolls really well, so he only has to spend half what he normally would in order to repair them. And then he goes to find and talk to Cass. And as they're talking, Drake Thunderbrand comes forward because Percy's trying to get potions for the party. And Drake delivers some potions. 3 greater healing, 1 regular healing, and more importantly, in my opinion, 4 potions of fire resists that last an hour. But after they take that into stock, Percy warns Cassandra to not get involved should they fail. In whatever repercussions happen, save the city, get underground, prepare for a siege, don't get involved. For some reason, I feel like that is an important character moment for Percy, but I don't know how.
Okay.
So, you know, just keep in mind in future episodes that particular moment. I don't know why, but I feel like that should have been an important moment. But after that, we jump over to Vax talking to Gilmore. Vax asks if Gilmore will join them. And at first, I thought Gilmore was going to say, no, I'd rather not. Because he had started talking about all of the trouble that he's been through, everything that he's lost. And I thought he was going to go into the, you know, I've just lost too much. There's too much fear. I can't do this. Instead. Yeah. Oh, go ahead.
No, I'm agreeing.
Okay.
I was of the same. I thought perhaps he was going to pike out, which didn't make a lot of sense in thinking about Gilmore, but it did at the same time because we keep forgetting he's just a shop owner. Like, he's got all of these gifts and powers, but he's not a soldier. He's not a warrior. He makes interesting potions and accumulates interesting items, and he's
he He hasn't been in combat in quite some time.
No, so it's asking a lot to ask this guy to not only join combat, but to be in the front line is no small thing to ask, so...
But what should have been no surprise to those of us here at Gilmore's Glorious Gossip, our boss had this to say. It is my just honor and vengeful glee to join you, if you'll have me. I love that line.
Mm-hmm. If you'll have me.
Which, of course, Vax is like, yeah. but Gilmore mentions, you know, having to go shake some of the dust off. And Vax responds with, I'm sure it'll be glorious.
Oh, yeah.
Boss, if you're listening, you get up there and you show them what glorious really means.
Mm-hmm.
So after all of the conversations conclude, they come back together. And Vex suggests having a hero's feast every night until they face Thordak. And just in case you don't get the importance on that, Vex'ahlia. Miss, I got pissed off because I paid full price for a book. Suggests spending 1,000 gold every night before facing Thordak.
Yes. Yeah, they're becoming a lot more happy to spend their fortunes, I suppose. I really think these guys don't think they're going to live. They are adamant that they are not going to live through this, and what good is gold when you're dead?
Absolutely. I don't know whether this was a character growth or a holy shit, we're scared moment. One thing that I want to mention and that I forgot to touch on before we moved forward. John O'Brien in the chat said that they had brought Allura as well. Not necessarily. Allura, we'll get to that in a moment. But Allura is not necessarily with them. And I'll cover that in just a moment. But yes, so after they discuss having the feast, they also discuss the potion distribution, and Percy gave his dragon slaying sword to, you know, anyone who thought that he could make use of it, and ended up going to Vax. And earlier in the series, Matt had ruled that the sword was a finesse weapon. And he stuck by that decision. However, as was pointed out in the comments of last episode, Matt also made it an attuned weapon. Whereas if you look at a dragonslaying sword in the DMG, it is not an attuned weapon. My thoughts on that is that because he gave it more abilities, it that technically makes it more powerful.
Yeah.
So you kind of have to balance that. And because it was turning it into a finesse weapon, attunement is not that big of a deal. Finesse is not technically that big of a deal. It sort of balanced it out.
Yes. John says Allura is supposed to go back to Whitestone. I was saying Gilmore says she is more powerful than he is. Gilmore does, as mentioned in the past, that she is more of a powerful sorcerer than he is.
Yes, but that's because she's She's been more focused on combat style casting, whereas he's on more of the enchanting style casting. So she's stronger in combat. But at the same time,
him being humble as well.
Yes. I was going to say, at the same time, Allura did not, go toe-to-toe with Thordak when he came back. And he was stronger when he came back than when she originally banished him. And Gilmore went toe-to-toe with him.
Yeah. So. Like I mentioned in our last podcast, we haven't actually seen a lot of Allura in anything, really, apart from making a couple of teacups fly around. So
yeah.
I would have loved to maybe see what she could do, but we don't really even know what she can do. So it's kind of hard to tell who would be the most powerful. But I really liked Matt's ruling in relation to potions here as well.
What do you mean?
So, I think it was Vax, or no, Vex, said, can you stack potions?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and he made the calling that, well, if you chugged, say, 4 or 5 potions, I'd have to ask you to make a constitution check, because you're like, you're mixing a lot of stuff in the bod. And I thought that was really interesting and makes a lot of sense, because, yeah, you are mixing a lot of different chemicals and enchantments in one canister, which is your body, to make a constitution saving throw makes total sense.
Yes. And actually, that's an optional rule in the DMG, mixing potions or drinking potions too quickly so that they actually mix in your stomach.
Very cool.
But, if they're two potions of the same type, like two fire-resistant potions, no, those don't stack. They don't even extend. If you drink them too quickly, they don't extend. It's just, hey, fire resistance. Hey, another fire resistance. Oh, look, I'm still just fire resistant.
Yeah, of course.
So. But then, Cash, they start getting into the meat of, what are we going to do when the battle starts? What's the plan? And Cash comes in with a great plan.
Thank God for Cash.
Yes.
This man, I was getting so worried and so stressed about this plan that they were putting together. Just, it wasn't happening. And they were kind of like, we're just going to go in. And it sounded like they were just going to go in and deal with it there. And I was like, oh my, because Matt was mentioning about the air, like there was dragons or wyverns in the air that had like air troops and ground troops. And Fuckersmuckin' was like, it wasn't until Cash came on the scene that they even thought about, well, what are we going to do with the air patrols? Like, we have to get that under control. And and Cash just took charge. And it's interesting because he is just an actor and a voice actor, but he played the soldier so well.
He's been reading Ender's Game by Orson Scott Card.
By the way, Ender's Game is an amazing series of books if you haven't read them.
Yes, the Enderverse is so amazing. Good. Now, so good. Here's an interesting thing. I know we are way off topic talking about this. But Ender's Game by Orson Scott Card, the first book in the Enderverse series, did you know it's actually taught at the U.S. Army War College?
Really?
Yeah. No. Only the first book. Because
They went a bit weird after that, but
well, I mean, they got more into the social aspect of things after that.
Yeah.
But it's just amazing.
That's interesting.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Anywho, so back in to the topic on hand. During the conversation, I can't remember if it was Vex or Vax put out the reminder of Jamansa Ord, and you know, Sam was like, "Yep, I remember him. I've got the flute still." And then Zara did a telepathic communication with Cash because Zara was worried about trusting Raishan. Which leads me to the question, what did Raishan do to Zara?
Yeah, and this came up again later when she had a bit of a private conversation with Vex. I don't know if you want to talk about that now or a bit later. When we get to our conversation with Vex,
we'll go more in depth into it later. Yeah. But
I feel like that conversation put more meaning behind that little snippet.
Yeah. Keyleth brings up that she wants to talk to the general of the Elvish armies tonight. They end up not doing so, but she wants to. The group ends up going ahead and eating the Hero's Feast before going to bed. And Hero's Feast will feed up to 12 people. So you've got Vox Machina, 7 right there. Zara, Cash, Gilmore, and Trinket. And then they have to choose between Kima and Jarrett. Because Jarrett is ranged, they decide to have Kima because she's more melee and will be right there in the thick of things.
Mm-hmm. Good choice.
I'm not so sure.
Oh, really?
So, the reason I say that is because the Hero's Feast gave them plus 17 hit points, immunity to poison, and immunity to fear. Kima, as a pure paladin, has the ability to shrug off fear if Matt remembers her abilities. Which he did not remember in the Beholder fight, but Kima is immune to fear. So.
Well, everything else should be helpful.
She has Lay on Hands to deal with poison. And the only benefit that she got from the Hero's Feast was the 17 hit points. And she's in plate armor. So
right.
She has a much higher AC than Jarrett.
Okay. That makes sense. So. That makes sense. Well,
oh, but well. Like I said, it's their game. It's just me kind of going, is this going to bite them in the ass when it comes to Jarrett surviving the encounter?
I trust Jarrett to keep low and out of the rain of fire, so we'll see.
Yeah. The next morning, they're talking about going to talk with the army before heading into Iman itself. And the Sindarin army, turns out they have about 2,000 troops. And during the discussion, they get into talking about the generals for each side. And there was a little bit of confusion in the Critter D&D chat because Matt starts talking about the generals. He doesn't clarify which one he's meaning. He just says the generals. And we've already met one general who was female. And Matt starts talking about another one who's male. But I think that he was the male one is one of the generals for the Elvish ranks. Because when you've got 2,000 troops for an army of that time period, you probably have 4 generals for those 2,000 troops. Granted, by today's standards, that's very few troops and very few generals for an actual army when you know you consider that the American army is 2 million strong. But by the same token, the Fort Daxio general was female. Not the same person as the War Master, because War Master Daxio is a male. But the general at Fort Daxio was female, so the male one, I assumed, was one of the Elvish generals. And that's when Zara pulls Vex aside to talk about Rashaan. And Zara warns not to trust her. In this point, Zara says that, you know, the more she tried to learn about Rashaan, the less she was able to discern. Mm-hmm. It turned out that Rashaan knew just about everything about Zara, but Zara knew almost nothing about Rashaan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was an interesting interaction because Laura, aka Vex, felt like there was something up with Zara to be having that conversation, something triggered for her, and she rolled an insight check on her, and she rolled pretty high. Earned a whisper from Matt. We're not too sure what Matt said, but Laura was very sad. If you watch her facial expression, she just changes after that whisper, and she looked like she was going to cry. I don't know, she looked very upset about something. It didn't seem to come back into play again later on. She still continued to interact with Zara as if she was herself and as if everything was normal. I do feel like maybe her memory might have been altered. We've seen Rashaan do that on Kima.
Yes.
I feel like she's been mind metal, like mind effed. And Zara maybe has spaces of memory that she can't remember, maybe pockets of things that she can't remember. And maybe that's why Rashaan seems to know more than Zara thought that she should.
Okay, I need to make a quick interruption because I'm getting yelled at in the chat.
Oh no! What
so, did we do? Well, we missed the shit moment. But as I explained in the chat, guys, we will get to that. I wanted to move that to the end because of how big of a thing it was.
The ship moment?
Yes.
It actually occurred after this chat, guys.
No.
It occurred.
No. This chat ship happened moment? The next... Yeah, this chat happened the next morning, didn't it?
Not according to my notes.
Oh, maybe. Well, I thought it was the next morning. Okay, I wanted to get all the talking done out of the way first.
But yes, yeah.
If we haven't even reached it at that point, then never mind.
I know. Don't stress, guys. We're getting there. So it actually happens next. We have that Percy and the Vex scene.
Oh, that's right. That's notes. Right.
Whether they're wrong, I'm not sure.
We'll get to it in just a moment then. We'll get to it in just a moment then. But yeah, I want to know what that whisper was about.
Yeah.
I really do.
It really impacted Laura. We could see that on her face. But yes. It didn't seem to impact the game or the interactions with Zara, so don't know. Don't know what's going on there.
By the same token, you know, when there was the... You know, later when it was Zara and Cash talking about the warning having already been passed, Cash brought up, did you tell him about the machine? What machine? we need to know.
Oh.
Because there's no information on the machine.
Right. I must have missed that. I remember that being said.
Yeah. So. But after that discussion, Keyleth, Vax, and Allura go to see the Ereshkigal.
Oh, yes, we are skipping a little bit. Yep.
They go and they talk to, or they gather those that are going, and it's just Keyleth, Vax, and Allura, and they tree stride to Zephra, where Keyleth is from. And as they're walking towards the village, Keyleth's playing tour guide. Vax and Allura are trying to get her to focus, and Keyleth's like, "Oh, well, yeah," but then right over there, that was hilarious.
Yeah, she played a very good Kiki this
Yes.
session. She was on ball with the Kiki. Yeah, I gotta love her.
Yes. So the Ereshkigal live on top of, I don't know if it's on top of a mountain or just on a mountain beside a set of cliffs that they live on top of.
Yeah.
But then, at first they don't recognize who it is, but it turns out to be Corrin, Keyleth's father, comes flying in on a sky sail, Avatar the Last Airbender style. Those things are
And
awesome.
Laura's face.
She
She's
wants one
like,
now.
Keyleth had access to these kinds of things all along.
Yes.
But I get the feeling that you would have to be maybe an Ereshkigal to use it. I don't think that's something that Laura could probably use.
At least you would have to have the ability to control the wind.
Yes, yeah.
But either way, or maybe just jump off a mountain and use it like a glider. But it's awesome.
Apps.
But Corrin's, it lets him know that he's been expecting them, and that Corrin and the Ashari are worried. The Ashari people in general worried about the threat that that Thordak represents. Corrin worried as a father about his, his daughter going into battle, as any parent would worry. But it seemed to me that that fatherly concern was misinterpreted by Keyleth. Like, she interpreted it to mean that, Corrin doesn't feel she's up to the task.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But I took it as Corrin's a father and does not want to see his daughter hurt. So.
Yes, yeah. And I mean, Matt plays her father so well. It's
Kind of
almost
creepy.
a little too well, yeah. John in chat said, "I love the comment Marisha made on Twitter about taking the punk boy in leathers and skulls home to daddy."
Yes.
That's totally what she did. I mean, they've met before, but yeah, she pretty much brought home the bad boy.
And on one hand, yes, they've met before, but I think because of how nervous Keyleth was for that reintroduction, I think he
Yeah.
realized, "Oh, you're dating my daughter now. Don't
It's
make me have to
a
kill
mental
you."
shift. Yeah. Yeah, there was that good comment that Matt dropped that said, Vex obviously trying to get brownie points. Vax, sorry, said, "You're a good man. Can see that." And he turned around and said, "Well, prove to me that you're one as well."
Yes.
And it was just delivered so well and so just out of the pen. Like, we did not even see it coming. So Matt, hat off to that. It cannot be easy to play the father of your
The father of your
wifey.
fiance.
That's
That's
really odd.
just awkward.
Funny, there
But
was no issue. He did it so well.
But as they're talking, Corrin brings up what is our sign to join the fight. And at first, Keyleth was suggesting, or Keyleth and Vax were thinking, well, we have flares. But Corrin's like, we're putting a storm overhead with a lot of clouds. Use your abilities. So,
which was a great idea by Kiki, by the way.
Yes. And I love that Marisha took that opportunity to throw a dig at all the haters. It's not as dangerous as everybody makes it out to be.
Yeah. Just chill before you get on my back. Chill.
Yes. Okay, and now... Well, hold on. One last little bit. At the end of when Corrin flies off, Keyleth remembers, oh, I forgot to introduce Allura.
Poor Allura was just standing there behind them, just like, she said, and this is Vax, but she never actually said, this is Allura as well. It was just so funny. And I was wondering if Matt was going to let it go, but no.
Well, Marisha did bring it up. Oh, crap, Allura, I forgot to introduce you.
Oh.
So.
Yes, you did.
But they go back to Whitestone, and then we have the scene. Percy grabs a bag and goes to talk to Vex. When he knocks on the door, Vex calls out, who is it? And of course...
Percy!
Of course, Percy pauses for a moment and tries to make a joke, which is overrode by Vex. Percy? And the common theory...
I have that off chat.
Yes, so but good. The running theory is that when she starts with the Percy, that's when she's hastily dropping clothes. Because when she answers the door, she is nude.
But naked. And Marisha was right. It's like, it's a power play. I love it. And it so is. I mean, Percy does not know what he's gotten himself into. He is just...
I mean,
he's always in control. He's always the one who has the last say. But you take on Vex, boy, and you're gonna get, you know.
And by bringing the drinks to her room, Percy was trying to take a guiding hand in the relationship. And Vex says, "No, you're not."
Yep.
So Percy pulls out and names the drinks he brought. This we just call courage. And then we're going to start with courage. We're not going to talk about dragon. I go in and I shut the door. Brown chicken, brown cow.
Oh, jeez. I don't know if that's the right thing to say there, but yes. You can fill in the blanks after this. And a lot of the fan art... We'll fill it in for you if you go searching for it. Don't worry about that.
Yes.
There is a lot of raunchy stuff that's filling my Twitter. I don't know about you guys.
So, the people in chat are laughing at my censoring. Blame YouTube. but, yes.
So it's a big place to put your face, Akiva.
Well, you know... Had the point of view been moved, my face would have been other places, but, you know.
And this piece is by Joma? Is this the Joma piece?
This is by Sir Joe Malicious himself.
The Buttman. Yes. So, yeah, you just have to have a good butt when it comes to Joma.
Yes.
Gotta love it.
So, moving into the next morning, they wake up, they have breakfast, they start to gather up, and Cash and Vax decide they're going to spar, sort of warm up a little bit. And during the the spar, Liam uses a luck. Not only did both the Critters D&D chat and the Geek and Sundry chat start panicking, but the players also panicked a little. What are
and
you doing?
Matt panicked.
Hmm?
Matt panicked. Matt was like, you know, you realize, you know, you're not going to get this back. Like, and Liam's like, I know, I've spent it. I've done it. Yeah. Like, it's done.
Liam took a moment. Or go ahead.
Yeah, no, keep going.
No, ladies first.
Oh, no, that's all I was going to say. It was just, yeah, even Matt was surprised that Liam was spending this luck at this point in time.
Yes. But Liam took that moment to remind everyone, it's just a game. So, that also became a hashtag that was used all over the place, and something that needs to be used more often when people start rules lawyering. It's just a game.
You kind of put us all in our place, so.
Yep. But after the first round concludes, Zara stops the fight by launching an Eldritch Blast in front of the two, and I was disappointed.
But it was good. She definitely knows when to cut a good thing and refocus it on what they needed to focus on. You can tell that she's a director.
Yes.
Yeah.
Guys, this doesn't support the story. Let's move on.
Yes.
So the group gathers, and Raishan appears in the Larkin appearance, and the Larkin watch is over. We have found Larkin. And of course,
he
Liam.
Has what?
And of course, Liam can't help but, you know, poke at everybody.
But,
so where's
Rachel? Where is Boris?
Yes.
We found one, but not the other guys. We still need to keep looking.
Yeah.
Poor Boris. And can I touch on Gilmore's outfit? Our boss looks fancy, Akiva. Ooh la la.
Well, of course. He is glorious.
I saw someone mention he's like a purple and gold Doctor Strange. I just thought that was perfect.
Yes. That is a very perfect way to sum that up, that outfit up.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, Allura teleports the majority of the group, but Scanlan stays behind with the guests that would not fit in Allura's teleport spell. And this is what they were saying in chat earlier, that they thought Allura had gone with them. The plan was Allura would take them to the camp and then go back to Whitestone. The Matt and the players, none of them mentioned that little detail that, yeah, she broke off and went back to Whitestone, but I don't think they really needed to, because they were focused on moving forward. And that little detail would have just slowed things down. But they get there, they open the tree stride, or Keyleth opens the tree stride so the others can come through. And so they go and talk with Warmaster Daxio. And it turns out...
Oh my lord. I'm sorry, Steeler Jet just said something in chat that... Can I just
go
bring
ahead,
up that everyone keeps saying Vex jumped the gun? Yeah, sorry. I'm so sorry, Akiva. I saw that.
I think to finish out the pun, it should have been Vex jumped the gun, man. The gun man. Because technically, Percy is a gunman.
Oh, boy.
Ba-dum-bum-tsh.
Yeah, it gets the good cringe, so yes.
So, anywho.
Sorry.
But yeah, so they talk with Warmaster Daxio, And it turns out the Elven army does not have any actual siege weapons, but they have, excuse me, they have enough mages to take on that role. The general plan from the army's point of view is they're going to infiltrate the city and then cause as much chaos as possible. The original plan that the army had come up with was, you know, get in and then take to the alleyways and such so that they're not being harassed by the flyers. But then Keyleth mentions, hey, the Ereshkigal are coming to take on the air forces of Thordak. Sort of even things out. So the plan changes slightly in that instead of, you know, splitting up into small groups going down alleyways, they're going to have larger groups in the streets. So I think that will really help them as things go on. And they discuss when to start and how to signal.
Yes. Now, I'd like to point out that Cash actually was the one who brought up timelines. Yes. So again, I am so thankful that Cash was here for this episode. If he wasn't here for this episode, I don't even want to think what might have happened, like what plan they might have gone in with. Because he was asking all the right questions. They found out, you know, how long is it going to take you guys, or what's your intended time frame for the attack and for entering the city. And at that point, Vox Machina realized, oh, we got to go now. Like, yes. This is not something we can go later. We got to go now. And yeah, it was so important. Zara made a good point about the sewers flooding, possibly, with the rain as well. So there were a few out-of-the-box thoughts from our two guests, which were key.
Yes. And it really made me wonder, because Will had said that this was his first D&D experience. Not this particular episode, but Critical Role was his first D&D game.
I know.
But the questions he was asking veteran players or military-minded players would ask.
Yes.
Mr. Friedel, what is your background?
Yes.
I mean, okay, taking at face value, this is his first D&D experience. Did he play Warhammer? Is he a real-time strategy video game player?
Yeah.
Like, probably. These questions were just so insightful.
Yes. Definitely seems like a passion of his, perhaps, that...
Yeah.
Maybe he's really into, like, wargaming, as you said, so yeah, I'd love to know.
Or maybe he's a war history buff. Who knows?
Who knows?
But, of course, the pit crew... Now, because they had talked about it on Talks Machina, I was really paying attention, and during the funny parts, when I would normally laugh, but I had forced myself to repress so that I could listen, the pit crew was laughing along with them. Or along with us, the critters.
Uh-huh.
Every once in a while, you can hear the pit crew moving around in the background, fixing something or whatever. And so, as as Vox Machina and their allies are leaving the tent and leaving the camp, there was a noise in the background, and Matt, you know, did his usual covering it with one of the NPCs doing something in the background, and of course Cash, or Will latched onto that and turned it into an even better scene with Cash seeing an old friend, Dale.
That was so good.
Yeah.
Matt could have just dropped that like just let it drop. But he played along. The improv between those two is such a delight. They're so good together.
And that just makes me wonder what I would do in a home game if a sudden noise popped up like that.
I did like that in chat everyone was going, it's okay, Pitgrew, you can laugh with us. Like, your critters too, laugh with us. And it was so much love, and I loved seeing that. 100%, they can laugh with us. We love hearing them loving it as much as we are. So,
and you know, as a testament to Matt, the pit crew, you know, admitted that a lot of times, you know, they're complimented for being so quiet in the background. I mean, that as they put it, the compliments that they got were along the lines of, "You guys are very disciplined. How do you keep a straight face when you're behind the camera?" And the pit crew admitted they don't. But Matt's storytelling is so compelling, and the players are so engaging, that most of the critters don't hear them laughing because they're laughing. Because the critters are laughing. But anytime we laugh, they're probably laughing too. So, yeah. But much love to the fact that Matt is able to make the pit crew part of the show, and the fact that the pit crew recognizes the awesomeness that is the Critical Role cast. And by the same token, the cast recognizes the awesomeness that is the pit crew.
Yes.
Big love fest there. Love it.
Great.
After that, the party and guests make their way to Grayskull Keep. And before they actually get into the city, they investigate the keep to see how it's withstood everything. And although it has been looted, there are a few things still left behind. And Taliesin goes down to his old workstation thing. And he actually finds a wire and connects Cabal's ruin, the cloak, to his glove, Diplomacy. The electric shocking glove that he had created, in order to try to be able to charge it at will. And that's a very interesting idea.
Yeah.
I hope that works out for him. I really do.
We'll have to see. Yes. He's a very smart man. Taliesin?
Yes. But they go ahead and sneak into the sewers. Once they get into the sewers, the Scanlan casts Seeming on a portion of the party to make them look like lizard folk. The others get turned invisible by Gilmore. And we have a short scene where Zara talks to Trinket. And it's cute.
That is cute, yes. Yes, Steelajet says, learn from my mistakes. We always had a moment of... oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, what is his name? What is the end?
Trinket?
No. Learn from my mistakes.
Victor.
Victor! Oh, lordy!
How did you forget Victor?
I know! How did I forget Victor? You know what? I forget people's names all the time. They're my enemy.
Yeah, it's
they're
okay.
My favorite enemy. His names. Yes, we had a good Victor moment there too.
Yes.
Because because they were trying to find something to go boom.
Yes, well, that was back in Percy's little lab. He found a mini keg of powder.
Yes.
So.
I know. I'm so sorry. I have had a big night, okay? Big night, big morning, big everything.
So, but, you know, as after the seaming and all of that, and after the trinket scene, they continue in the sewer, and they hear voices up ahead. And it turns out to be members of the CLASP. And, you know, they try talking, and of course, seeming works against them at that point. But Vax, you know, pops up with, "I used to be one of you. I used to be CLASP." And Laura, without missing a beat, "And then I took an arrow to the knee." 2014
It just won't die. It just won't die.
and then in Karmic Retribution, the twins have to roll a persuasion in order to get the CLASP to actually talk with them and not, you know, either fight or flee. And they get ones. Both of them get ones.
That's certainly what it was. It was karma. It was karma for that reference, bringing it back again.
Absolutely. But, you know, as I said in the Critter D&D chat, you know, this is just another example of the dice being their own character.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they are as much a part of the story as the players are, so.
Doing that once is rough, man.
Yeah.
And you could see that Matt wanted to give it to, like, I forget, Max was, like, trying to say, you know, "Can I do this?" And Matt, like, "Oh," he's like, "It's a one, man. Like, I can't. You rolled a one. Like, you guys, I have to have this be that you guys have just screwed this up." Because he wanted to give it to them, but he couldn't.
Yep. So the CLASP members take off running. Vox Machina and guests chase them down. And Scanlan has to persuade them through a door. They come across a trapped and locked door.
Mm-hmm.
Which Scanlan, having as high a charisma as he does, is able to do so. Steelajet is bringing up a good point that I should have made. Because of the situation, the roll was at disadvantage for the twins. And Laura did get a nat 20, but also a nat 1.
Yes, because there were a voice coming from nothing, because they were invisible. Makes sense. Good call. But yeah, that's why you get Scanlan to talk, man. Don't get anyone else to talk. Scanlan's charisma is just ridiculous. Yes. Just wow.
But, you know, they get through the door, and they have a very short conversation. "Hey, we need to get through here so we can go fight Thordak. The fight is going to start any minute now. We have to get there." They're able to convince them to lead them towards the city center, and they're dashing through the sewers, and eventually they come up on an area where it just gets hotter and hotter. And eventually there are holes in the sewer, and they can see lava through it. And my thought, like, the notes even for that portion of the game is just heat, lava, holy shit.
Huh.
So, but they eventually exit right outside the Cloud Top District. The Ashari Storm, because the Air Ashari had summoned a storm to roll through. And they're doing some initial combat. Just little harassments, nothing major.
Yep.
And then Keyleth throws up the Skyrite just as Cash and Zara start a fight with two fire giants that are guarding the gates.
Yes. This was really interesting how this played out, and I got the impression that Matt didn't intend for Zara and Cash to get caught up with the fire giants. I got the impression that he actually put that as a pre-encounter.
Yes.
Because he mentioned, you know, you guys just bypassed all of this stuff. But the moment I saw two fire giants, and I thought, Zara and Cash, it was like perfection. And I don't think Matt meant it to be that way, but it just worked out that way. And story-wise, epic. Just so epic to think that these two who have been through so much together, and literally you could have a show, like a Zara and Cash show. I would watch the crap out of that show. They are just such an amazing duo. It's just that visual of her, like, holding these two fire giants in place and him, like, ready and defensive as these little fire, I'm assuming they're little elementals, are jumping out of the buildings to attack
they're not
him
little.
From behind.
They're not little.
Large. Very scary fire thingies. The image in my mind just was amazing. It was beautiful. A beautiful way to end it. Yeah.
So, as this is starting out, Zara casts Evard's Black Tentacles and grapples the giants and drags them to the ground. Keyleth throws up the Skyrite, and Cash and Zara stay behind to deal with the fire giants. The rest of the party just runs by into the gate in order to go face Thordak.
Yeah. As Zara said, welcome to hentai.
Yes.
I just loved that line. Like, welcome to hentai. I'm like, oh boy, this has just gone to a whole different level. Everyone in chat is winning. Yeah. Everyone out in chat is pointing out that she did say, are you ready? I think she said, are you ready, my love? To take this on. I'm not sure what the relationship is between Zara and Cash. And
so, in the past, they have said they're just friends. They see each other as brother and sisters. Keeping in mind, things can change, but if you look at Zara's speech patterns and the way she says, and she has called Vex and Vax and Grog and pretty much everyone in Vox Machina, she's called them love. The only difference is this time she said, my love. Not just, are you ready to do this, love? It was, are you ready to do this, my love? And I don't know, I can't say for certain, because obviously I'm not Mary, but I can't say for certain if it was just a slip of the tongue or if it was intentional. And lot of people are hoping that it's intentional.
All the ships. Let's just ship everyone.
Yes.
It was also said in a different tone, kind of a bit more endearing and loving.
Yes.
Of a tone as well, so that's, I think that did it for me, was just the way that she said it and delivered that line. I was like, oh, is there something going on? Because that just sounded so, so caring and personal, but
yes. And
maybe
as
they'll ask on Vox Machina and they'll let us know. I don't
Hopefully.
Know, they might keep it to themselves.
Hopefully. But as PJSmith97 in the chat says, well, Kima and Allura were, quote-unquote, just friends, too.
That's
so,
fair.
That is fair. So, the rest of the party rushes in, and then out of the ground, slamming through the street, Claw, digging into the stone, pulling himself up. Thordak rises from the depths, his eyes shining like a molten sun. And yet, with Vox Machina right there, he says, "It seems we have guests. Where are you?" So is Thordak blind?
Yeah, so Matt kind of touched on this a little bit after the game and said that it was more of a moment when he was taking all of it in, and in that very moment of time, he didn't see the party. So it kind of felt like Matt was dispelling that theory quite quickly. But I don't know. Those eyes, man. There's got to be something going on with those eyes. I mean,
well, I don't doubt he's an elemental dragon now, but
yeah. I don't know. We'll have to see.
All I know is that the party was like, "Can we very quickly, very fearfully, kind of just sip our fire resistance potions?"
Can we chug them now?
Yep.
Sorry, boys. I think that's going to be an action or bonus action. In the next episode, the battle!
The showdown is next week.
What perfect timing. Their last show. Will it be their last show?
Their last show of 2016 is the Thordak Showdown.
Wah! It's like you couldn't plan it any better. So excited.
Yes.
Epic. Epic. Poor Matt. I feel sorry for him. But I'm too excited to really to really worry too much. I'm like, I feel for you, Matt, about what you're going to have to go through in those 4 hours next week, because it's going to be on him. He's going to have to be doing so much work for 4 hours. That battle is going to be huge. But I trust he can do it.
Yes. So, that leads us into notes that you put down, Kat. If you want to go ahead and introduce these.
Yes! So one of the things that we noticed when he pulled himself out of the tunnel, the hole, was that crystal in his chest was gone. And it was all scarred over. So the biggest question of the day is, what happened to the crystal? Did he absorb it? Is he, like, what happened?
I think he's... So, going back to last week's theory about Therizdin...
Yes.
I think it's becoming... It's being used to power an elemental node.
Yes. I'm with you. Yeah, a lot of people are saying that he absorbed it, and he... But yeah, no, I'm with you. I think he's sitting on it.
Yes.
Literally. Literally sitting on it. Yes. So that'll be interesting to see. And I mean, if he goes back down into that tunnel, into that hole during the battle, how that's going to play within combat, you know, will that be a problem for Vox Machina? Are they going to have to go down there? Is he more powerful when he's down there? I don't know.
John O'Brien... Go ahead.
Yeah. No, you're right.
John O'Brien in the chat asks, who removed it? Was it Raishan? Was it Allura? Neither. I am more than willing to bet that it was Thordak himself who removed it and is using it in whatever machine that Cash and Zara had mentioned earlier in the episode.
Yes, I think it was just part of his transformation as he, with whatever deal he made, whether he knows he's made it or not, is coming to fruition, and he morphs and changes. That crystal probably removed itself because it has a plan to play. It has a part to play in the plan. Oh, wow. Say that fast 20 times. It has a part to play in the plan, and... yeah, I think it was just part of the whole process.
So, but yeah, it's just, So interesting.
So exciting.
Yes, interesting little breakdown you found on Reddit.
Right, yeah, so this, from my Rhinor Unshot? Oh gosh. My Ryan or whatever. MYRYNORUNSHOT on Reddit did a breakdown of the party and the challenge rating that he feels it's all at. So he has Gilmore as a 16th or 17th level wizard. Akima is at 14th and fifth or 15th level paladin. And
With a
I
Holy
haven't checked any
Avenger.
of these. With Holy Avenger, I haven't checked any of this, by the way, so if it's wrong, rip me. You have four level 16 PCs in the Vox Machina party, two level 15 PCs, one level 14 PC, all with legendary items. You've got Jurat, who has been a guard. It seems like a guard-based NPC, but we feel that maybe Matt will make him a little bit more, maybe a fighter, maybe give him some skills there.
Either a fighter or a ranger, considering his job and his preferred weapon.
Yes. And then you've got Raishan, an ancient green dragon, and Jamon, if they blew that whistle, an ancient brass dragon. So you've got quite a freaking powerful party that you're looking at there. So based on that, he feels that the challenge rating for Thordak has got to be around 25. 24 to 25 CR level monster to be of any challenge to a party such as this. But I mean, we're not quite sure how Matt's going to utilize those NPCs. Some people thought that maybe he's going to keep the non-Vox Machina NPCs busy with ads, if I can use a WoW term,
It
other
works.
little ads. So perhaps, you know, it's going to be just Vox Machina against Thordak. In which case, I don't think that challenge rating is going to change. I would agree. I'm thinking we're looking at. And I mean, so when you think about it, so Lockerin from Reddit mentioned that deity level encounters are challenge rating 30. So they're hitting those high levels now. Which, wow.
So
Wow.
here's my thought with the party breakdown. Gilmore, Kima, Drake, and Jarrett will likely be on ads, as you said. Raishan, I think, is going to turn on them. They're going to call in Jamon, and Jamon's going to deal with Raishan one on one. Those two are going at it, leaving Vox Machina alone to deal with Thordak by himself.
Right.
So,
Perhaps. Yes.
it's wow.
Luck, Matt. Good luck. That
Well,
is a
I, you
lot
know,
of plates to spin in a battle.
yes and no. I think the way it's going to go depends heavily on how Vox Machina does against Thordak. And again, this is assuming that Mary and Will are not on next week in order to finish up the Fire Giant and then rush in to help Vox Machina. Because if they are there, they're going to be helping Vox Machina. They're not going to be on the ads with all the others. But that will help Matt because then he can just say, well, the outcome of their fights are going to deal or going to depend on the outcome of the fight with Thordak. And if there's communication between Gilmore, Kima, Drake, and Jarrett and Vox Machina itself. Because I mean, granted, Kima has some healing, but if they need an assist and there's no communication, well, Matt can just choose who dies for story effect.
Yes.
The other option I see is, and again, this is based on the presumption that the NPC characters are again off on their own. Matt may run that battle separately beforehand, just off on the side, either by himself or even getting the pit crew in on it, which would be cool. Run the game for them over a weekend.
That would be cool.
That would be cool. Let them play the NPCs just to see how the battle will go.
A little difficult, I think, to do it that way, because you're not really sure what's happening.
Well, you're
in
not
the middle, but
kind of. But I mean, if you
I
are,
get what you're saying.
If you're separating them, then it is possible to do that.
Yeah.
So.
Z and Kasha toast. No, stop it.
Who said
stop
that?
Stop it.
Who said that?
Comic book addict.
Comic book addict, no pessimists here.
We are getting a lot of concern for our Z and Cash couple, and what's going to become of them.
Yes.
So I would love for them to be back next week and for us to have those two battles in tandem. Maybe two tables, two maps. That would be... I know it would definitely lengthen and probably bog down combat a little bit, but
so,
I think everyone really wants to see that.
I was daydreaming, you know, probably about a month and a half ago of how this would be handled once they confirmed that there was an army and all that. And in my daydream, I had Cash and Zara and even Will Wheaton, his character.
Yes.
And all the guests, you know, behind the scenes, and them doing a tandem DMing, have a guest DM for just them, running whatever battle they're going on the side.
Oh, wow. That would be epic.
And then Matt, yeah. the Matt and whoever the guest DM is, communicating via texts, hey, we're on this round, hey, we're on this round, until the end, and say... battle complete. So, this group won.
Yeah. Wall breached, or this place has been lost, or...
Yeah.
These guys have died.
Yeah.
Oh, that would be pretty cool. A nightmare.
Oh, yeah.
Probably.
Logistically, like, that is a nightmare.
Yes, but... Would be awesome to say. I'd be all on that.
Absolutely. But I think that will wrap things up for us this week.
Yes.
Again, we don't have anything specific that we wanted to talk about for DM's Corner. So we're just going to go into our outro. And we hope you guys enjoyed the episode. For the questions that we asked during the thing, if you have a response, please feel free to leave those in the comments below. One thing that I did want to mention, I've had like one or two individuals ask about it. YouTube has been changing a lot of things recently and how that might affect us. And really, it doesn't. It just means that we will never be on the YouTube front page. Basically, YouTube is trying to push for long-form daily content. And while we have long-form, I really could not do long-form daily content. So we're going to stick to the weekly episodes that we do. And like I said, it's not going to affect us too much. But that being said, if you enjoyed the episode, click that like button and subscribe to catch us each and every week. Send in any of your D&D questions to us using the hashtag DMsCorner. If you want to submit art, please contact us via Twitter. You can use our official @Gilmore_gossip. Or you can contact us directly. I'm @AkivaDavid, AkivaDapHydd.
And I'm @CastielGames, CastiL3L Games on Twitter.
We hope you enjoyed, and until next week, kick back, relax, and enjoy your games.
May all your hits be crits, and have a nat 20 day, guys.